the scriptures. Praise the Lord. 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 8 to 18. Elisha, amen. Elisha was in a situation. Elisha was in a situation. He was about to be captured by the king of Syria. And the king of Syria sent some army to arrest him. I'm sure some of you are familiar with that story. And when he woke up in the morning, there was this army that was gathered around Elisha. And the servant said, "Ah, Elisha, we are finished. Look at this army that came to get us." Elisha said, "Do not be afraid, because those that are with us are more than those that are against us." The servant said, "Elisha, you must be kidding. Are you blind? Look at the people that are around us. We are just two." Then Elisha prayed. He said, "Open his eyes." Amen. And the Lord opened his eyes and he saw chariots of fire all around Elisha. What that tells me is that as you're sitting here, there could be chariots of fire all around you.
Yes.
Amen. That's what it tells me. It tells me that there's a world behind the naked eyes, behind what we see. And that world is the spiritual world. Praise the Lord. In the spiritual world, so many things happen. In the spiritual world, they have beings. Amen. Praise the Lord. They have the occupants of the spiritual world. Amen. God is in the spiritual world because the Bible says God is a spirit. Praise the Lord. And they have all kinds of beings there in the spiritual world. As we're sitting down here, they are interacting. Amen. We are in the natural world, like we have beings here. We also interact with one another. But we also interact in the spiritual world. Praise the Lord. But since planet Earth and the natural world is God's focus, this is where all God's attention is directed. Amen. So the spiritual world seeks to determine what is going on in the natural world. In fact, the spiritual world controls what happens here. There's nothing that happens here unless it first happens in the realm of the spirit. Or it has been sanctioned and approved in the realm of the spirit. Amen. The thing that happened to you today had been approved earlier. Sanctioned, concluded, happened in the realm of the spirit. Amen. The things that are going to happen to you tomorrow and next tomorrow and next year, amen, are being deliberated, argued over, fought over in the realm of the spirit. That is why it's important that you make an input into the realm of the spirit so that you can be able to control the things that are happening to you. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Talk to someone and say, "I understand what the pastor is saying." Amen. Amen. So everything here is determined. And spirit beings, because our choice is here, the decisions we make here affect what goes on in the spiritual world. Because our choice is here, decisions we make here affect what goes on in the spiritual world. We have the power here to affect things in the realm of the spirit. Amen. And in the realm of the spirit is where this battle is being fought between God and the devil. But we have power here to affect what goes on there. Because we have that power to affect what goes on there, because we have power to affect what goes on there, that is what is going on. Every being in the realm of the spirit wants to operate in the realm of the natural. Maybe you have lost me. Okay. What am I trying to say is that God wants to operate in the natural. The devil wants to operate in the natural. Amen. The fight is for what is going on here. We are the objects of the battle. Amen. Praise the Lord. But what we do, the decision we take here affects, amen, the outcome of the battle there. And because of that, in order to ensure that the decision we take here will be in favor of one party, either God or the devil, God wants to operate in this realm, the natural realm. The same thing the devil wants to operate in this natural realm. Do you understand?
Right.
They want to operate here so that they can influence directly what we do, what we say, how we live, how we behave. They can influence directly our choices. But there's a problem. The problem is that God cannot operate here unless he has a body.
That's right.
And the devil too cannot operate here unless he has a natural body.
That's
where the problem is. Amen.
Amen.
Even God is limited. That's why when God wanted to come to earth, he has to take the body called Jesus. And he put on that body and came to earth so that he will save us from our sins. Amen. Praise the Lord. And all the time Jesus appeared, even in the Old Testament, he came as a body. He took a body and came and appeared to the prophets of the Old Testament and ministered to them. Touch somebody and say, I'm still with the pastor. Amen. Now the devil also seeks to operate here. He needs a body too to operate, to carry out his wishes. Amen. Now watch this now. Watch this. I want us to remember the story in the book of Genesis when God created Adam. When God created Adam, the Bible says that God carved out a garden for Adam. Amen. God carved out a garden for Adam. And the garden was secured. And Adam and Eve were living in the garden. The Bible says that God comes down to discuss with them. Praise the Lord. God comes down to discuss and interact with them. Amen.
Amen.
And fellowship with them. Praise the Lord. But the devil could not get access to Adam and Eve. There was no room for the devil to tempt them. Do you know why? Because he had no body. Amen. There was no way to tempt them until he found the snake that was ready, the serpent was ready to lend its body to the devil. That is why when God caused the serpent. Because the serpent yielded his body and allowed his body to be used by the devil to communicate with Eve. Because there was no way, because there's a barrier between the spiritual and the physical, that unless you have a body, you cannot operate here. You cannot operate here unless you have a body. And the devil knew that Adam and Eve were in the garden, but there was no way to reach them. If he comes, because he's a spirit, Adam and Eve will not see him. Amen. If he manages to get in there and start shouting, they won't hear him. Amen. He needed a natural body to operate in this realm. So he went to the snake, the serpent, and said, will you lend me your body? And the serpent said, yes, I will. And he entered the serpent, and he went there, and he began to speak to Eve. Praise the Lord. And he spoke to her and tempted her. That's why when God was cursing, God first cursed the serpent before he cursed the devil. You didn't get that. Okay, let me read it for you so that you will understand. Genesis chapter 3. Are you there in the book of Genesis? It's the first book in the Bible. Shout hallelujah if you're there. Amen. Amen. Now, look at it from verse 13. From verse 13, are you there? And the Lord God said to the woman, what is this you have done? And the woman said, the serpent deceived me and I ate. Why did the woman report the serpent? Because the serpent before then, which was the snake, are you following me now? And man had fellowship. And it was the fellowship of truth and honesty. All the animals were interacting together. Adam was the one that gave them names. Amen. And they talked to each other and communicated with each other. So when God said, woman, why did you do that? He said, it's the serpent that you kept here with me. I trusted him that he was my friend. But he deceived me. Amen. Then God went to the serpent. Do you understand? You see, there will be no need for Eve to blame the serpent. Praise the Lord. If not, that the serpent broke the rule of honesty that was entrenched in the Garden of Eden. Amen. Look at it. So the Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, verse 14, you have caused more than all cattle and more than every beast of the field. On your belly you shall go, and you shall eat dust all the days of your life. That was a curse on the serpent physically. The snake. Amen. He said he's cursed above all cattle, that is above all animals, he's cursed. And he said, on your belly you shall go. It means that the serpent probably had legs before. Amen. Had less before. He said, and dust you shall eat. It means that the serpent was not eating dust before. Now, the serpent eats dust. Now, that was the curse on the physical snake. Now, look at the curse on the devil. He said, and I'll put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. That was the curse on the devil. This curse on the devil was a prophetic statement to the coming of Jesus. Say there will be an enmity between you and the woman and between her seed. Now it did not say your seed. It said your seed, one, and her seed. Amen. And he shall bruise your head and you shall bruise his heel. This prophecy pointed to the death and resurrection of Jesus. Jesus was going to go and bruise the head of the devil. Are you still with me? That was the curse on the devil. What am I trying to tell you? What I'm trying to tell you is that the serpent was cursed because he allowed himself to be used by Satan to tempt Eve, to get access to Eve. And that's what happened in the Garden of Eden. And that's, immediately that happened, Satan now had access. Because the Bible says that he that committed sin is a servant of sin. So once the woman has sinned, she became a servant of the devil. And the devil had the right to now enter her and use her. Amen? He had the right to now enter the man and use him. That's why by the time they gave back to Cain, Cain already had the spirit of murder in him. Where did he learn how to kill? Who told him? Who taught him? The devil had entered his body and spoke into his heart and said, kill your brother. Do you understand? Now in the case of Cain, Cain does not need somebody on the outside to come speak to him. Why? Because now the devil was living inside him. Are you still with me? You are still with me. Praise the Lord. Tell someone I'm still with the pastor. Amen. Amen. So you see, because the devil was not living inside of him, he never needed anybody to tell him how to kill. He had something to speak to him. But that is spoke from the in being sad. He needed no serpent anymore. The devil had broken the barrier and had access to the body and the minds of men. And from thence, the devil began to inhabit men and began to operate here through men. Amen. When the devil wants to do something, he will enter somebody and use the person to do it. Amen. The same way God too began to seek to use people. So the Bible says the Spirit of God used to come upon the prophets of God. God will seize them and use them to do what he wants to do. Then God began to look forward to the day when he will pour out his Spirit upon all flesh. When he will not just come once in a while. When he will come and indwell man. And he sent Jesus to make that day possible.
Amen.
When Jesus came and died, it was possible for now to God for to enter into man and indwell man and use man to do what he wants to do.
Amen.
Are you with me?
Yes.
Are you with me?
Yes.
If you are with me, shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Now the devil entered Adam because Adam agreed with the devil. Eve agreed with him. By that agreement of obedience, she entered into an agreement, into a covenant. By agreeing to do what the devil tells her to do, she entered into a covenant with the devil that made her body accessible to the devil. Amen. Christ also comes to live in us when we agree with Christ and say, I recognize what you're doing for me. I accept it. I want to enter into this new covenant with you. Come into my life. And then he comes in and dwells in us. Praise the Lord. He comes in and dwells in us. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Now, without this kind of agreement, no spirit can enter the body of somebody to indwell the person. Without this kind of covenant or agreement. Praise the Lord. No spirit can enter the body of somebody to indwell the person without an agreement or covenant or a reason. Amen. No spirit can do that. Even God will not do that. There must be a covenant, there must be an agreement. Where am I taking you to? Just wait 1 minute, I'll get you there. Amen.
Amen.
You see, after Adam, God now proposed that he was going to send his son to take a body born of woman that will come and pay the price. And pay the price so that man will be free. When God proposed that, the devil began to set about, amen, disrupting God's plan. Amen. The devil began to set about disrupting God's plan. And how did he do that? Are you still in Genesis? Genesis chapter 6. Genesis chapter 6. Genesis chapter 6. Ah, Holy Spirit, help me to speak accurately in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Are you there in Genesis chapter 6? I'll read from verse 1. Now it came to pass, when men began to multiply on the face of the earth and daughters were born to them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men that they were beautiful, and they took wives for themselves of all whom they choose. And the Lord said, my spirit shall not strive with man forever, for he is indeed flesh. Yet his days shall be 120 years. There were giants on the earth in those days, and also afterward, when the sons of God came into the daughters of men, and they bore children to them, those were the mighty men who were of old, men of renown. The devil began to draw up a plan to disrupt God's ability to get human flesh in which he will dwell and redeem the earth.
Amen.
How did he do that? The fallen angels began to sleep with women and began to give birth to children. The Bible says the sons of God. Who are the sons of God? Go to Job 1 so that you know who the sons of God are. Job 1. The book of Job. So that you know who the sons of God are. Job chapter 1. Are we there in Job chapter 1? Verse 6. Verse 6, are we there? Now, there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them. Do you know who the sons of God are?
Yes.
Who are they?
Angels.
They are angels. The angels are called the sons of God. Amen. Amen. Now, in chapter 6, go back to Genesis chapter 6. He said the sons of God were having sex with the daughters of men. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Amen. They are having sex with the daughters of men. Praise the Lord. That's what he said here. It means that these sons of God are not the angels of God. They are the fallen angels. The fallen angels began to sleep with the daughters of men. And the Bible says they gave birth to giants in those days. Amen. Those giants became men of renown. Those are the giants that tried to build the Tower of Babel. The Bible says this man that they gave birth to, look at, if you read verse 5, it says, then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the heart, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was evil continually. They began to sleep with them, and that way, the devil sought to pollute the entire bloodline of the human race so that there will be nobody that God is going to use to give birth to the Messiah. Are you with me?
Yes.
As they began to sleep there, they began to give birth and intermarry. That was why when God chose the Israelites, he gave them one instruction. Don't marry anybody that is not a Jew. Hello. When he chose Abraham and Israel, he said, don't marry anyone that is not a Jew. Many of us do not know the reason why God destroyed the world of Noah was for this reason. The world of Noah was destroyed not because they committed more sin than we are committing, but they were destroyed because the entire bloodline had been polluted, except Noah's bloodline. So God decided to destroy the entire world of Noah and started a new race through Noah and his children. And then he chose Abraham out and he called out the people of Israel and he gave them one instruction, never intermarry. Don't ever marry a non-Jew so that you will not pollute the bloodline. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And the Jewish kept, it was a serious crime for a non-Jew, for a Jew to marry a non-Jew. It was very, very serious until the Messiah came. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Now, you see, the devil's intention is to dwell our bodies. And God's intention is to indwell our bodies. And most of us, we were born in sin. When we were born in sin, most of us were born into this world with strange spirits indwelling our bodies already. Then after a time in our lives, we now give our lives to Jesus, and we repented. If you've not repented here, if you're not born again, wave your hands. If you are not born again, wave your hands to the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. And we gave our lives to Jesus and we got born again. The fact that we got born again does not mean that the demons that were possessing our body or that were living in our bodies had gone. Amen. There are some who that preach that Christians cannot be possessed. Praise the Lord. It is true. Because the word possession means to own completely. You cannot own a Christian. The devil cannot own a Christian completely. But Christians are demonized. They have demons living in their bodies. Amen. The demons do not stay in the spirit. The demons stay in the body. Some people say, how can a demon be there when the Holy Spirit is there? The book of Job says, when the sons of God went to see God, Satan also, and he had a conversation with. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. So you see, demons don't stay in the spirit. When you get born again, the Holy Spirit comes into your spirit. It is the Holy Spirit that gives birth to a new spirit that's in you or resurrects your spirit that had died. And the Holy Spirit stays in your spirit. That's why when you get born again, you receive the Holy Spirit. It is different from the baptism of the Holy Spirit. When you get baptized in the Holy Spirit, you're giving the Holy Spirit access, amen, to your entire body. You're completely immersed in Him. Praise the Lord. But when you get born again, the Holy Spirit stays in your spirit. Demons don't stay in your spirit. Demons stay in the body. Demons don't need your spirit. They need your body. They stay in the body and try to influence you and try to hinder us, amen, from the purposes and the plans of God. They try to mar our destiny and change our destiny. That's what the Bible says. It says on Mount Zion, Obadiah chapter 1, it says on Mount Zion there shall be deliverance, and then there shall be holiness, and then the children of Jacob shall possess their possessions. The reason why some of us have not possessed our possessions is because there are demon spirits that inhabit us that do not allow us to possess our possessions. It's not difficult for God to bless, but there are powers of darkness that have access to us, not just our bodies, our spiritual environment. Amen. And intercept the blessings of God. And they stop us from being blessed. And they operate through various means. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Demons are always trying to inhabit our bodies. And while they are there, they hinder us. Because when they are in our bodies, they can influence our thought life. They can affect, amen, our decisions. All they will do is to make the body feel contrary to the spirit. That's why God will help those of us that are ruled by our feelings. I don't feel like it. I feel like it. I don't feel like it. You're walking in carnality. You're supposed to be ruled by the Spirit of God in you. Amen. They enter our bodies and try to use our bodies or try to influence us. Try to influence us in our bodies. They make our bodies to feel contrary to what the Spirit wants to do. That's why the book of Galatians says that the Spirit lusteth after the flesh and the flesh after the Spirit. Some people believe that the flesh is just bad. The flesh is bad because there is something that entered into the flesh. When God created the flesh was good. Because everything that God did was good. But the flesh became bad because something entered the flesh and stayed in there. You see, our bodies are like houses. Amen. They are like houses. And you can be in your house, and you could be living in your house, and there could be a rat, there could be cockroaches, there could be ants, there could be termites, there could be spiders, there could be all kinds of things in your house. And you may not even know, because some people say, if I'm demonized, I don't know about it. Yes, if there are cockroaches and all that, you do not know until you see their destructive acts. If you open your pantry one day and you see some paper eating, then you begin to say there must be a cockroach in this house or a rat. That's how you get to know. Praise the Lord. Because some people say, if I'm demonized, I should know. No, the devil does not want you to know. When you know, you want to do something about it. Amen. So it does not want you to know. The devil's biggest weapon is ignorance. And that's one of the problems with the church. Because the church does not want to face that it is demonized. That the reason the church is not succeeding and working in the power of the Spirit is because there are demons in the church. The church does not want to accept it. And rather than cast out demons, they are looking for every excuse everywhere. Amen. Amen. The Bible says, in my name you shall cast out demons. Jesus' first encounter with the demon was inside the church. In the book of Mark chapter 23. He went into the church and he met a demon. Don't you remember the story?
Yes.
He was in the church. The demons are in the church. Amen.
Amen.
As we meet up and to sing praise, they join us and sing praise. When we move out to the hinder house, that's why they sit there in the church and cause all kinds of strife and all kinds of things in the church. Because they are there. But the church doesn't want to face up to it. Because the church doesn't want to look at itself in the mirror and say, I may be demonized. It's too much for spiritual arrogance. How can I, so holy, prophesying, be demonized? So we don't want to accept it. And we don't want to accept it, we stay in ignorance and allow the devil to walk all over us. And hinder us. Because that's why we don't receive the things that are made for us. Because there are demons operating in us, hindering us, preventing us. And we don't want to face up to it. Amen.
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 Praise the Lord. God is coming for a church that is pure and without wrinkle.
Amen.
Holiness does not just mean living a holy life. It means being cleansed of every filthiness. Every uncleanness that is in us. If there is an unclean spirit in you, you cannot be holy. It doesn't matter how straight you walk and how holy you live. You cannot be holy. That's why in Jesus' ministry, 60% of his miracles was casting out demons. Over 60%. He did more of casting out demons than healing. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Are you still with the pastor?
Yes.
You know, I want you to understand this because you cannot be delivered unless you understand it. Deliverance begins with understanding, with knowledge. And most of us will run from one place to the other seeking deliverance without seeking the knowledge. Hello, you cannot be delivered unless you really understand what deliverance is about and what you're being delivered from. You cannot be delivered. Amen. That's why it's important that you understand what I'm telling you. That's why I'm taking the trouble. I will come here and stand and say, stand up, let's begin to pray. I begin to call out the demons. Come on. Everybody begin to shake and all that. I want you to understand it. If you understand the purpose of Satan and what he is trying to do, that all he wants to do is to live in your body and use you. Amen. Then when you get delivered, you will stay delivered. You will not allow him to use you. Because anytime you yield unto him, the Bible says that he, Kalima Satan, the Bible says that he that sinned is a servant of sin. And you cannot remove from that, he that sinned is a servant of sin. So anytime you yield to sin, you make the devil, you become a servant of the devil. At that point, he has every right to inhabit you and use you. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Are you still with me?
Yes.
You still love your pastor?
Oh, yes.
Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
This was the dilemma that Paul had in the book of Romans, chapter 7, when he said, the things that I want to do, I do not do. The things I do not want to do, those are the things that I do. If I do the things that I do not want to do, it means that it is not me that is doing it. Then who is doing it? He said, it is sin that is in me. How is sin present in him? As a spirit. When we interpret it, we say, it's the human nature. What is human nature? Nature is the totality of your character or your habit. Nature is the same word for character. It's the totality of your habit. Praise the Lord. That's what nature is. Amen. Nature is the totality of your habit. And your habit does not just come out from somewhere. Praise the Lord. It was established by an act. Amen. Which was established by a thought. But the thought did not come from the blue. Amen. A spirit established it. Praise the Lord. The spirit, the habit of anger, amen. The habit of anger, amen, is established by the spirit of anger. Praise the Lord. The habit of drunkenness is established by the spirit of drunkenness. Amen. The habit of lying is established by the spirit of lying. The habit of failure, of poverty, or of lack is established by the spirit of failure. The habit of fear, trepidation, is established by the spirit of fear. That is why some of us run into trouble when we try to break the habits without casting out the spirit. Because we try, we cannot break the habits. We must first get the spirit out. When we cast the spirit out, then it will be easy to break the habit. But even after you have cast the spirit out, you must break the habit. When we don't break the habit, whenever you go into that act, you become a servant of sin and the spirits come back in. Do you understand?
Yes, Pastor.
Do you understand?
Yes, sir.
Do you understand? The Bible says, he that has ears, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches. I thank God that in America they are beginning to understand a little bit about deliverance today. They are talking about Harry Potter and talking about what witches and wizards are doing. Amen. How they are trying to introduce witchcraft through the Harry Potter books and Harry Potter movies. And that is the truth. But we've been experiencing this in Africa for some time. They recruit our children in the school with sweets, candy. Amen. Yes. I was casting out a demon from a girl one day, and the demon said he came from Ethiopia. I said, we are in Nigeria, what are you doing here from Ethiopia? How did you enter her? How did you come into this girl? He said, I entered when her friend, called the name of the friend, gave her bread to eat. That's how I entered. And when he entered, he went and brought all his cohorts and his friends in. And I said, get out. He said, no, I won't go. She ate my bread. And I said, well, she has eaten, she ate only your bread. She ate the flesh of Jesus and drank his blood. That's more powerful than your bread. You must leave. And the spirit left. Amen. That is, you see, demons are spirits that don't have bodies. And their ultimate aim is to stay in our body. When I started on demonology, the Lord began to teach me that they want to stay in our body so that they can affect us. But as I began to understand what demonology is about, the Lord began to reveal to me that one of the reasons why they stay in our body is for protection. Some people are apostles now. Open your Bibles again. The book of Matthew. Open Matthew. Matthew chapter 12. Matthew chapter 12, are we there? Matthew chapter 12. Are you there, Matthew chapter 12? If you are there, shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Shout out. Are you getting something out of this?
Amen.
Okay. So that all of you will start casting out demons in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Verse 43. Verse 43 says, when an unclean spirit goes out of a man, he goes through dry places seeking rest and finds none. Hello? Did you get that scripture? Okay, let's all read it together. Verse 43. When an unclean spirit goes out of a man, he goes through dry places seeking rest and finds none. He said, when you cast out a demon out of a man, he goes through dry places seeking rest. If he's going to seek rest, it means that where he was, he had rest. Hello? Are you with me? If he's going to seek rest, it means that where he was, he had rest. And the Bible says, he seeks rest and he does not find any. Look at it back. Then he says, I will return to my house. Why did he want to return there? Because he had rest there. He said, I will return to my house. To the body from which you cast out. Because he couldn't find rest any other place. So he will return. Because I was wondering why these demons are so desperate to get into our bodies. It's because when they are in our bodies, they find rest. What do they find rest from? Amen? Because, you know, I told you, I said there's a battle going on. Between the forces of light and the forces of darkness. So if a demon is passing by here now, and an angel sees him, what will they do? There will be a fight. But if demon is hiding inside my body, and I'll be redeemed by the blood of Jesus, what will the angel do? He will not touch him. Are you getting this? I want you to understand this very well. Because that's why you must not allow them. If a demon is passing by, an angel sees him, what will do? They will fight. But if he's inside my body, and I'm redeemed by the blood of Jesus, the angel will not touch the demon. He's safe. That is why he wants to stay. That's why he will find rest inside my body. That's why when the demons saw Jesus coming, they see him, they say, have you come to touch us? They become afraid. Amen. When even Jesus encountered the demoniac at Gadara, yes. When he just wants to cast out, he begged Jesus, he said, please, let me go into the swine. Why is he so desperate to go into the swine? Because he will find rest there. He must be in a body in order to be safe from the angelic bullets and arrows that are flying around. So he has to stay in the body of an animal or of a human. And when the demons entered the swine said, no way, we can't have you. They ran into the deep and died. So they are forced to leave that body. Amen. So, because they are supposed to tell you, they say, well, the demon is not bothering me. I don't need the deliverance. Well, it may not be bothering you, but it's you're giving safety and protection to a demon. Amen. Do you understand that? Do you understand that? Because they stay in our body. I don't want no demon in my body. I'm telling you, that's why I fast and pray. That's why I come against them. In Jesus' name. I don't want to be an agent of the devil. I don't want to be used by him in any way. Amen. Praise the Lord. They stay in our bodies to find rest. Because outside there is no rest. That's why we must not allow them in our bodies. Not only because we affect them, but because they stay there to find rest. Can we rise up to pray? Some of you, because you do not pay your tithe, you are possessed with the demon of mammon, the love of money. Kandoli Brosete, command that demon to get out of your life. Rima Sakotaili, Robos Etoni Brosete, command that demon. Some of you, because you have been abused before, and you have been rejected before, you have the spirit of rejection operating in you that makes you not to be able to keep a relationship. Come against those spirits now. Every demon associated with those sins, every demon associated with the past, command them to get out of your life. Command them to get out of your life. Break every covenant with demons. Break every covenant with foul spirits. Break every covenant with hell. Break every ancestral covenant. Break every covenant that you inherit from your forefathers. Break every curse that you inherit from your forefathers. Break every soul tie. Some of us are coming through bloodlines that are heavily demonized. Begin to break every connection, every covenant that has been made in your bloodline, in your lineage with the devils. Every covenant has been made in your lineage with devils concerning your life. Begin to break them in Jesus' name. Take authority over them and break those covenants. Take authority over them and break those curses. Take authority over them and break those soul ties. Take authority over them. Kandani Brosete. Come against them. Rima Katonia. Prasto Tani Brosete Masete. Broske Pani Loskipara Masikatari. Rakoni Broskepra Masete Moshini Katoria. Come against them in the name of Jesus. Come against them in the name of Jesus. Break them in Jesus' name. Break them in Jesus' name. Break them in Jesus' name. And command every demon associated with those curses. Every demon associated with those covenants. Every demon associated with those soul ties. Every demon associated with those sins. Every demon in your body. Command them to leave. 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 To get out and return no more. To get out and return no more. This is not the time to be self-righteous. This is the time to cleanse yourself and rid yourself of every contamination, every spiritual corner. You are my healer. You are my source. You are everything to me. Today, in the name of Jesus, I renounce. I break. I destroy. I render null and void every connection, every covenant, every association with the devil, with his agents, with the spirit of sin, with witchcraft spirits, with marine spirits, with water spirits, with familiar spirits, with snake spirits, with controlling spirits. I break every covenant with spiritual husband or wife. I break every covenant with the powers of darkness. I break every association, every connection with spirit of rejection. I break every connection with the spirit of failure. I break every association with the spirit of poverty. I break every covenant with the spirit of barrenness. I break every connection With the spirit of hindrance, I break every connection with some destructive spirits. I break every connection with the spirit of. I destroy every soul tie with the devil in the name of Jesus. I destroy every covenant made by eating in the dream, made by sex in the dream, made by incisions and tattoos. I break every covenant made by visits to psychics and visits to false prophets. I break every covenant with that I inherited through my parents or my grandparents or through my bloodline. Every covenant that they have with Freemasonry, with demon powers, with voodoo priests, with idols, today I break them, I destroy them.